Welcome to the story of Robert and Clara Schumann. Thank you for coming out in this very unusual winter weather this year. Here we go, with no further ado. This is the program, and we will guide you through the program with the PowerPoint. And this is just a list of our performers today and accompanists. And this is a little segment from a movie about the Schumanns, Katharine Hepburn.
Do you know a little poem? It's called Dedication. I've set it to music.
Joy. Ladybug, fly away home. Your house is on fire, your children are crying, and the wicked spider's spinning them in. Ladybug, fly away home, your children are crying sorely. Ladybug, fly off next door, for no harm will come of you there. They also want to see your bright wings, so send my greetings to them both.
When Clara's parents divorced in 1825, her father recognized her exceptional talent and assumed custody, as was customary at the time, and took charge of her musical training in piano composition and theory. Through her father's tutelage and connections, she quickly became a child prodigy and began what would be a successful career as a concert pianist at age 14.
Composing gives me great pleasure. There is nothing that surpasses the joy of creation only because through it, one wins hours of forgetfulness when one lives in a world of sound. Clara. If you love me for beauty, do not love me. Love instead the sun with its golden rays. If you love me for my youth, do not love me. Love the spring for its new every year. If you love me for my riches, do not love me. Love the mermaid with her pearls. But if you love me for love's sake, then yes, love me forevermore.
Thank you. when Robert was 16. So, I forgot to mention, if you could hold your applause till the end. Thank you, though. When Robert was 16, his father died. A few years later, in 1828, at the urging of his mother, he went to Leipzig to study law. While Schumann's mother appreciated his musical activities at home, she discouraged Robert from seeking a musical career as she felt the profession had held little promise. However, in Leipzig, Robert met the highly esteemed piano teacher, Friedrich Wieck, and here's his brilliant 9-year-old daughter, Clara, at the piano. Robert immediately makes a plea to study piano with Wieck and takes up lodging at the Wieck household. Robert's skills in improvising at the piano and storytelling were captivating to Clara. It wasn't long until she fashioned a crush on a dashing young Robert. Robert recalls later in his diary, long walks with Clara. Clara, who is as fond of me as ever, is the same wild, fanciful little person, skipping and tearing about like a child one moment and full of serious sayings the next. It is a pleasure to watch the increasingly rapidity with which she unfolds the treasures of her heart and mind, as a flower unfolds its petals. The other day, as we came home from Connewitz together, we did a 2 or 3 hour tramp. Nearly every day, I heard her say to herself, "Oh, how happy am I? Who does not love to hear that?" Along this same road, there are some very unnecessary stones in the middle of the footpath. Now, I have a way of looking up and not down when I am talking. So she walks just behind me and gently pulls my coat every time I'm going to step on a stone and keeps me from falling and stumbling. Since Clara was rather young at 14, Robert directed his attention to another more developed pianist, pupil of Wieck's, Ernestine von Fricken. Clara was deeply hurt by his attentions to her. She writes, "How clearly I recall the first afternoon after our return from Hamburg, when you came into the room and hardly even greeted me. I went to Auguste, who was with us then, and said between my tears, 'Oh, I don't love anyone like him,' and he didn't once look at me. Those were the miserable days when you didn't even care for me in the least. And when you did talk to me, you just teased me." This is now Der Mond kommt still gegangen.
The moon rises silently with its golden glow. The weary earth falls asleep in beauty and splendor. Thousands of loving thoughts from the faithful drift over those who slumber. The windows sparkle in my beloved's house, but I gaze silently into the dark world.
Thank you.
However, in August of 1835, Robert was informed that Ernestine was the illegitimate child of von Fricken's wife's sister. To make matters worse, Baron von Fricken had determined that she would not receive any dowry when she married. This, combined with a cooling of his affections, led eventually to a mutual breaking of the engagement. Clara was relieved and continued to show her attachment to Robert. Clara's letters to Robert showed playful attention and a cleverness that was lacking in Ernestine's correspondence. As Clara entered womanhood, Schumann's view of Clara gradually changed. Clara grows daily, even hourly, inwardly as outwardly, more delightful. It was November 1835 when Robert first kissed Clara and declared intentions of marriage. Clara wrote to him later, "When you gave me that first kiss, I thought I would faint. Everything went blank, and I could barely hold the lamp that was lighting the way out." Here is a duet by Fanny Mendelssohn Hensel in 1837, so this is 2 years prior to Robert's composing of Dichterliebe with the same text. Here, her setting of Heine's text, it expresses the blooming of love and the onset of spring. Article, Robert Schumann and Clara Wieck, A Creative Partnership. She writes, "The false hopes raised by Wieck, Clara's waverings and his own despairs, all forced Schumann to summon his reparative functions again and again. He had suffered many losses, a sister, a father, a brother, a sister-in-law. But more pertinently to his composing were the fresh losses of the courtship years, during which he also lost his mother and a second brother, and lived under the intermittent threat of losing Clara. These were conditions amid which Schumann created his great early compositions, Clara is struggling most intensely to free herself from her father.
Clara wrote, "Father shipped me off to Dresden on that account, where I again grew hopeful, and I said to myself, how pretty it would be if he were only your husband." From Dresden, Clara also wrote to her dear Herr Schumann, advising him, "Drink less Bavarian beer. Do not turn night into day. Let your girlfriends know that you think of them. Compose industriously and write more in your paper, since the readers wish it." With Clara away, Robert made a move to Vienna with the idea to broaden his audience of Die Neusichtigkeit für Musik in Austria. While unsuccessful in winning approval for his journal, Robert found Vienna home of Mozart, Beethoven, and Schubert musically stimulating.
So I had the wrong pages. Stick to the one that was stapled. So I should just clarify that
So she receives her first kiss from Robert, and he proposes, well, they form a strong attachment, and her father finds out and ships her off to Dresden because he doesn't like this idea. He's turned Clara into this amazing pianist, and she's bringing in good income, and she's performing with pianists like Chopin and Franz Liszt, who are touring all over Europe as virtuosic pianists. So now her father has taken her away from the temptation of Robert. And now we will hear Sehnsucht nach der Welt gegend by Robert Schumann. And in the postlude, Robert begins to send a musical, he's very into the encrypting these little clues of love into his music that he composes. And he writes in her theme, which you'll hear in the postlude, which in musical terms, C-L-A-R-A, is C, B-flat, A, G-sharp, A. So here is Roslyn Black, and Katrina will read the translation.
If only I had never left you, wonderful forest. You have held me lovingly in your embrace for so many years. From your springs and bird songs have many songs sprung from my breast. Now parted from you, everything seems empty and mute to me, as the bird only half sings when parted from his leafy tree.
So Robert has expressed here in the poem that he is like a bird who only half sings when he's parted from his leafy tree. So Clara is the tree that he's missing to make himself whole. So his moods continue to swing as he reflects in his diary. In the night of October 17th, 18th, in 1833, the most fearful thought that ever a man can have suddenly came to me, the most fearful which heaven can use as a punishment, that of losing one's mind. It took hold of me, but with such a violence that all consolation, every prayer was silenced, as if it had no more significance than score and derision. This fear, however, drove me from place to place. I could not catch my breath at the thought. Suppose it suddenly happened that you could no longer think. So next we will hear In der Fremde, sung by Ainsley, and Faith will read the translation.
From my homeland, beyond the red lightning, the clouds come drifting in, but father and mother have long been dead. Now, no one knows me there. How soon, ah, how soon till that quiet time when I too shall rest beneath the sweet murmur of lonely woods, forgotten here as well.
Continue to plan for an eventual union. He writes to Clara, "When you are standing by me as I sit at the piano, then we shall both cry like children. I know I shall be quite overcome. Then you must not watch me too closely when I am composing. That would drive me to desperation. And for my part, I promise you too, only very seldom to listen at your door. We shall lead a life of poetry and blossoms, and we shall play and compose together like angels and bring gladness to mankind." Clara writes to Robert. Clara writes to Robert. "So one little yes is all you want. What an important little word it is. Surely a heart so full of inexpressible love as mine can utter it freely. I can indeed say it. most in my inmost soul whispers it unceasingly to you. In der Nussbaum, the nut tree, a young maiden rests under a nut tree, and the breeze through the branches whisper of a wedding next year as the future bride listens. Writes to Clara, "Are you loyal and true as ever? My confidence in you is indeed unassailable, but the stoutest heart would be disconcerted when left without a word from the dearest thing in the world, which is what you are to me. I have turned the matter over in my mind 1,000 times, and everything tells me that it must come to pass if we make up our minds to carry it through." Clara writes to Robert, "Do you still doubt me? I must forgive you, for of course I am only a weak girl. Weak, yes, but my soul is strong, and my heart steadfast and unchanging. Let this be enough to destroy all your doubts. Their separation both challenges and inspires Robert. Here the poet describes himself as a bird wanting to fly near his beloved. When he's sleeping, he is speaking to her, but when he wakes, he finds himself alone. This is Wenn ich ein Vöglein wäre, a duet.
If I were a little bird and had two little wings, I'd fly to you. But since it cannot be, I shall stay right here. Though I am far from you, I'm with you as I sleep, and I speak with you. On awakening, I am alone. Not an hour of night goes by without my heart awakening and thinking how you 1,000 times had given me your heart.
When Clara returned to Leipzig in 1838, Wieck continued to forbid their meeting. Robert would have letters delivered secretly by Dr. Reuter. I long too much to see you, to press you to my heart, that I am very sad and also sick. I don't know what ails me, and yet I do know your absence ails me. I can imagine you everywhere. In my room, you walk back and forth with me. You lie in my arms. But nothing, none of this is real. I am sick. I can't stand it much longer, Robert writes. Clara, too, began to take on some of Robert's depressive symptoms. When I saw you walking by, it was as if I would sink into a coma with pain. Everything turned black before my eyes. Then when I could no longer see you, the tears started flowing, an indescribable feeling. Clara was torn between her love for Robert and her desire to continue performing and her alliance to her father. She suggested to postpone the wedding after Easter of 1840 so she could earn more money, because Clara was definitely more financially stable than Robert was at that time. He writes, I did not expect you suddenly to smash my last hopes. You have demoralized and weakened me so much in my activities and thought that I want to leave here immediately. Between the two of us, we have a nice little income and the brains and hands to earn twice or three times as much as we need. But you want, by all means, to be a millionaireess, and with that, I no longer want you. It was a stressful year leading up to their marriage as they engaged in a fierce legal battle with Wieck. Through all this heartache, Robert was still composing some of his best songs. A letter from Clara, art is a beautiful gift. What indeed is more beautiful than to clothe one's feelings in sound? What a comfort in sad hours. What a pleasure. What a wonderful feeling to provide an hour of happiness to others, and what a sublime feeling to pursue art so that one gives one's life for it. Next, we will hear Liedje Braut with Shana singing, and Rosalind will read. So leading up to their marriage, Robert and Clara didn't find support from Clara's father, but they were supported by Clara's mother, who lived in Berlin, and they spent some time there.
The Bride Song. Mother, mother, never believe, because I love him so, that I cannot love you as before. Mother, mother, since loving him, I love you all the more. Let me press you to my heart and kiss you. Mother, mother, only since loving him can I truly love you now for giving me life that now has become so radiant.
Increasingly, Robert turns to composing songs and writes to Clara, I cannot tell you how easily all this has come to me and how much I enjoy doing it. As a rule, I compose them, songs, standing or walking, not at the piano. It is quite a different sort of music, which does not first come through the fingers much more directly and more melodious. Perhaps Robert is moving away from the piano to gain freedom from his piano teacher, Clara's father. Robert eloquently blends verse and piano so they become united in a powerful force of expression. The piano and voice assume more equal roles, blending to express through both words and feelings the human condition. Many songs close with a brilliant, beautiful postlude, as you just heard. So here now, leading up to Dichterliebe, his great song cycle. How shall I begin to tell you what a different creature you are making of me, my dear, you splendid person? Your letter led me from one heaven to another. What a new life, what glorious prospects you opened to me. Sometimes, as I go through our letters, I feel like the first man as he was led by an angel through a whole new creation. As they go from height to height, where each new prospect is fairer than the last, the angel says, all this is thine. Is all this really mine?
In the wondrous month of May, when all the buds burst open, then it was that my heart was filled with love. In the wondrous month of May, when the birds were singing, then it was I confessed to her my longing and desire. From my tears there will be spring many blossoming flowers, and my sighs shall become a chorus of nightingales. And if you love me, child, I'll give you all the flowers, and at your window shall sound the nightingale's song.
Schubert's other very famous song cycle is Frauenliebe und Leben. And this is der herrlichste von allen.
He is the most wonderful of all men, gentle and loving, with sweet lips and bright eyes, a clear mind and firm resolve. Like a distant star that gleams bright and brilliant, so does he shine in my sky, bright and brilliant, distant and sublime. Wander, wander on your path. I'm content to humbly gaze on your radiance, to be but blissful and sad. Do not heed my silent prayer, uttered for your happiness alone. You shall never know me, lowly as I am. You are a noble star of splendor. Only the worthiest woman of all deserves you. then I shall bless that exalted one many thousand times. Then shall I rejoice and weep. I will be blissful even if my heart is breaking. Break, O heart, what does it matter?
So finally, in 1840, Robert and Clara get permission from the courts to marry, even against Wieck's disapproval. And so Wieck, all this year in 1840, he's been told to summon evidence because he's been trying to prove that Robert is unfit, unstable, and philanderer and an alcoholic, which he kind of was, but then Clara, you know, who was this traveling performer, she was not really well suited either to domestic life. And in case, you know, there was that picture with her with her five children. She was pregnant 10 times, had 8 children, and you know, she was traveling all over Europe, Paris and all around Austria and Saxony or Germany, and they took a tour to Russia, and you know, they didn't hop on the Delta flight out, you know, she was getting in carriages, and you know, think of that. I mean, I just find it mind-boggling. And she was the primary breadwinner at the same time. Really quite extraordinary. So here is Clara on her wedding day. She decides that it would be good for them to have a marriage diary. So they have lots of, once they get together, there's a pretty good record of their lives. So she writes, we were married at Schönenfeld at 10 o'clock. First came a chorale, and after that, a short address by Wildenhahn, a preacher, a friend of Robert's youth. His words were simple, but heartfelt. My whole self was filled with gratitude to him, who had brought us safely over many rocks to meet at last. I prayed fervently that he would preserve my Robert to me for many, many years. Indeed, the thought that I may one day lose him is enough to send me out of my mind. Heaven avert this calamity, I could not bear it. There was little dancing, no excessive gaiety, but every face shone with real satisfaction. The weather was lovely, even the sun, which had hidden its face for many days, shed his warm beams upon us as we drove to the church, as if to bless our union. And our last piece, perhaps Robert's most signature piece that you heard in the movie at the beginning of the program, Widmung, or Dedication. You are my soul, my heart, my joy and pain. You are the world in which I live, my heaven in which I float, the grave into which I eternally cast my grief. You are rest and peace. You are bestowed upon me from heaven. That you love me makes me worthy of you. Your gaze transfigures me. You raise me lovingly above myself, my good spirit, my better self.